Right now, let's move into the community programming initiative. Put a few coins in the slot. We talk about your city, your agency, your business. You guys know all about that. Let's turn our attention right now just a few blocks to our north, and let's look at the city of East Chicago. In the studio right now is the mayor of East Chicago, and that is Mayor Copeland. Mayor, how are you today?
I'm doing fine, doing fine. Good morning, Jet.
Hey, you know, it was nice to see you out at the Dynasty Banquet Center yesterday. A huge showing for the economic development panel. I was honored to be the moderator for that, but there were a lot of people from the rest of the state that were part of that and that had come up here to see what we were doing. And the comment I got from these folks on the panel and some of the other observers from Indianapolis area was, wow, you guys really have a good energy in the business community. And I think, you know, Hammond and EC both showed themselves off well yesterday.
Well, you know, I sat next to Mayor Tomic McDermott, and we were able to exchange ideas and experiences. Like I said, I just got my first year in about 3 days ago. I'm able to bounce things off of him. You're right. We had diverse views of what economic climate is in this area. Some say that happy days are here again, then some say, no, slow it down. All indicators say that it's going to be slow growth. It was good to get the opinions of bankers as well as local business people. We had, you're right, we even had people as far as Indianapolis come and sharing their ideas from the state. So, but in it all, I think everybody see that Indiana is ripe for growth. They exchange the ideas of that if we keep doing it right, the people from Illinois is going to keep crossing over. We can see that with the Walmart situation in Hammond. We can see by our taxes being lower than theirs along our borders that they're going to keep crossing over. But I think it was Marcus Morton. He hit it right when he say that we shouldn't just look at Illinois. We should say all of the adjoining states. We should be siphoning from all of them. You know, so I walked away with more than I brought to that conference yesterday.
Yeah, you know, Morton, he is a card. He used to have a show here, and he pointed out one thing that, you know, it was mostly most of the folks were very laudatory towards the 3-2-1 plan and what it's doing for efficiencies in government. And he pointed out two things that I thought were interesting. One was that there's basically taking a lot of the power from the local units of government, including cities like your own, and taking it to the state. And the second thing is that, oh, it's all, everything's great and efficient until you got to run down some of our roads, which we don't have enough money to fix because of the pothole. With that being said, you passed your budget recently.
Yes. And to share what you were saying, what Marcus Morton had shared with the audience, if you look at the 1-2-3 tax caps for a city like East Chicago, where the tax rates kept spiraling upwards, I think when it reached its peak before the 1-2-3 cap kicked in, we were at about $9.36. So it was good for a city like the city of East Chicago to be put on a diet. I mean, and face the stark reality that we had to start trimming down. So Marcus is right when he say we're limited because we don't have the ability to control our tax rate anymore. But at the same time, I think it was a blessing for the city of East Chicago. But you brought it up, the budget. Yes, it was passed. The council and the executive side have come on one mind with that budget. The budget is overall $2 million. I've been cut from the general fund from that budget. When I came in 2010, flowing into 2011, we had cut an additional $2 million. So in the swing of 1 year, we have cut roughly $4 million off of the deficit. Also, the one thing the budget will also will reflect is we are moving away from our dependency on gaming. In 2010, the city of East Chicago relied on $13 million in gaming. In 2011, we reduced that to $8 million of reliance. In 2012, you're looking at $5.5 million we will rely on gaming. And if the voters shine on me, come November the 8th, then you will see in 13, we plan to use roughly $1.5 million until we move on to zero dependency on gaming. So that budget reflects caution. It reflects that we will attack this problem that we have in a systematic fashion and slowly reduce our dependency and our diet for, you know, spending too much. So
219-845-1100 if you'd like to talk to Mayor Anthony Copeland. We'll take one right now. Hey, you're on the air with Mayor.
Hey, this is Ramon.
Yes, sir. How you doing this morning?
Yeah, I'm doing all right. Hey, I live in Gary, but I want to give you a congratulations for the way you're running East Chicago.
Thank you very much, sir.
And I hope in the future with you, Karen, and Tom from Hammond, Mayor Tom McDermott, and I hope you all get together and help Gary get a Walmart.
Yes, yes. Well,
you know, on the East End, you know.
Well, you know, Gary has the population almost any big box, they should be able to support it with their population and along with the communities that adjoin that city. That's something I've always been amazed at. When you go down the interstate and you exit off into Gary, that you never see the big boxes. I've always been amazed at that.
All right, man. Thanks a lot. 219-845-1100. Hey, sorry, I cut a couple people off there on that were trying to wait, but my fault. Hey, you're on the air. What's up?
Hey, question, Mayor Copeland. I would like to know when you will have a public debate with your runner-up, John Aguilera.
You know, usually I don't touch on political issues since this is paid programming by the citizens of East Chicago, but I would make one comment toward that. John Aguilera endorsed me at the caucus in October. Then in around February, April, he announced his candidacy on the steps of City Hall, saying that he was running in the primary. Then he stopped. Then before he said he was going to run against George Pabe, then he stopped. Then he said he was going to. So at what point should I stop in these dire times we in and take him serious? My concentration has been on bringing the city of East Chicago on an even keel, and I haven't looked back.
All right, man. 219-845-1100. Hey, you're on the air with Mayor Anthony Copeland.
I want to know what his plan is for the city. How are we going to get it moving forward? How are we going to get this crime down? You know, this answer he's given about this debate, he's dancing around the issues on the air. I want real answers.
Here you go. Well, let's ask it. Mayor, what is the plan to, let's just take one issue, okay, address crime?
I can tell you, as becoming mayor, that one of the toughest decisions I had to make was to, we have four officers getting ready to get on. And because of the fiscal situation, we could not hire them. I looked at our staff and I saw we were top heavy in the front office, and we have put 11 more officers on patrol. So, and we have seen the difference that has made. So, you know, crime, has it been going up? We have seen that across all the communities. But I can tell you that it is quieter in the city of East Chicago. I can tell you that we have opened up the city to federal authorities coming in. I have sat down with CAP. You will see in the next 2 months, the investigative work that's been going on, a lot of it I can't speak on it, you know. We have the FBI currently in our city. These are the type of things you don't rant and rave about, because these investigations are happening and they will bear fruit. But you can see a difference in the city of East Chicago.
219-845-1100. Hey, you're on with the mayor.
Oh, how you doing? This is Daryl calling back.
Hey, Daryl.
I'm doing good, Daryl.
I know the mayor is smiling. Hey, what I want to say is at this conference that you guys were at yesterday.
Yes.
Was that guy that doing these commercials on TV that got 165 Wendy's? Was he there?
No.
You're talking about Bridgman.
Yeah.
You're talking about Bridgman, former senator.
East Chicago, Washington.
And I know you remember him, right?
Yeah.
No, he wasn't there.
He should have been.
Yeah, but he is set to come to town pretty soon. He supposedly came last year. He has promised us that he will come, so we're looking forward to seeing him.
Yeah, tell him put on the corner of Main Street and Columbus Drive.
Okay, well, like I say, he has promised us that he will come. We're looking forward to see a native son return. So, and he has been very successful.
All right. Hey, thanks a lot, Daryl. 219-845-1100. I'm talking about Junior Bridgman. Played for East Chicago Washington's 1971 state champion.
Mm-hmm. Yes, and he's speaking on. He has about 100, and they say about 65 Wendy's.
Yeah,
across the nation.
Yeah, very, very successful person. By the way, also with us today is Val with the mayor's office. And obviously a lot of people address the questions to Mayor Copeland, but good to have you in here, Val.
Good morning, Jeff.
219-845. As a matter of fact, I didn't even have his mic on. And
we
go to him. As soon as we need a detail, we'll go to Val, and he'll know what it is.
You know, also, Jed, I want to touch on that. We will be opening up the Railroad Avenue Bridge. We're looking at the first week in November. That should alleviate a lot of the traffic problems that we've been having. You're looking at all of Tide Avenue from 141st to Chicago Avenue. All of it has been resurfaced. The stormwater drains have been repaired. So it should alleviate a lot of the problems from the traffic that we got coming off during the peak work period. So we're looking forward to that.
219-845-1100. Hey, you're on with Mayor Anthony Copeland.
Hey, Mayor.
Good morning, sir.
My very next question, when the bridge was going to open, and you know, over the last year while it was being built, it really didn't get much play in the papers or in the news. Can you ask, one, you have any idea how much that cost, who financed it, and since I'm through there every day, is it going to be a legal truck route?
Yes, it will. It will be the alternative truck route. It used to be. It's perfect for it because it leads you back from Indianapolis to Columbus Drive,
right,
to Railroad, then back to Chicago Avenue. Then from there, you can head to Klein Avenue. So before, we used to give out tickets when trucks wouldn't go that route. So
right, I know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that project has spanned three administrations. It started off with the Pastrick administration going to try to find federal matching dollars. Then the Pabea administration picked it up. The project actually started under the Pabea administration, caught fire and started being built. And then you can see the completion during the first year of my administration. So it's been an effort across three administrations. And it's a beautiful bridge.
It kind of sounds like the little problem we have in Highland Munster Hammond with the Little Calumet River. But at least you got it done within 28 years, right?
About 12 years, roughly, and that's without me taking my shoes off. But it's a beautiful bridge. When they were building it, they lifted on the Chicago Avenue about 4 feet, 4.5 feet. It was an awesome thing to see. I didn't see how you was going to have such a smooth transition, but it's there. And like I say, the company that did the work, I don't know it off the top of my head, but they did a nice job. It would be four lanes. You would be able to come off the bridge and turn and make that right turn straight into Chicago Avenue. So,
I'm sure that was a pricey bridge, but Mayor, I'm glad it's getting done under your administration.
Mm-hmm.
And guess what? You only have one more bridge to go.
Well, you know what?
Thanks a lot. We'll talk about that right now.
Yeah, since the caller went there, we can talk about Klein Avenue. Right now, the governor is making a decision on what he want to do with Klein Avenue. I can respect his decision. Some people may have said that we have seemed to be like a yo-yo effect. This week is going up. Maybe it's going to stay down. Next week is going up. This week, maybe it's going to stay down. But the one thing I applaud the governor for is to still be considering alternatives that some people may say are not popular. But in my heart, for all the things that I've seen, the indicators point to that bridge will be going back up. I'm looking at possibly us getting the answer within the next 2 weeks. Well, I pray that we do. But the city of East Chicago needs that bridge to go back up. The local economy needs that bridge to go back up. And like I say, I applaud the governor on his patience.
And before we go any further, I do want to mention the Harvest Moon Hayride is tonight.
Yes.
At the Roxana Center, right over the Nine Span Bridge. I think it was early.
At MacArthur Park.
Yeah.
It was originally set for MacArthur, but I think due to the rain everything.
Yeah, they had to move it out of MacArthur. Okay. So I wanted to make sure everybody knew that. That is right over here at Roxana. That's going to be $2 a piece, and it'll be from 5:30 to 8. Come and experience the Harvest Moon Hayride event. This event is like no other. Recreation Department combines the sights and smells of autumns and the fright of Halloween with a haunted trail hayride. If you have any questions on that, 391-8476. Now, go ahead, Mayor.
Well, I want to put another plug in for the senior building project that we're working on at Broadway and Alder. That project has started. I'm proud that this is my administration's first effort in bringing the contractors and the developers to bear to say that you will hire local. We've had meetings set up. The residents have come. Our local contractors have been part of this bidding process at its incipient stage, the beginning of the project. I applaud everybody coming together, seeing where there's inefficiencies that we plug those gaps, but at the same time have compassion to see that we have to flip those dollars over when it comes to every project in the city of East Chicago. It's an $11.5 million new senior building that's going up. It's 54 units. And like I say, it's just been a beautiful thing. We have a local contractor tearing down the old buildings that's on the site. We have landscapers that will be from here cutting the grass that have already secured contracts. We have people here locally that's getting contracts for the snow removal. So we see the need. Before in the past, things will get built and you wouldn't get local participation, but we embrace that in this administration, and I'm proud that that the developers and the contractors see that it's better that we get along on these projects.
East Chicago Mayor Anthony Copeland is in the studio. If you want to get your phone calls, do it now. 219-845-1100. We actually have some open lines. Also, I do want to remind you guys about the Sharing is Caring canned food drive. That's going on started a week ago, and it will be going on till November 15th. You can drop off any canned goods at Bessie Owens, Heritage Hall, Marktown, MLK, Pennsylvania, Roberto Clemente, or Roxana Community Center at any of those places, and they'll take those. If you got any questions on that, 391-8476. Let's go to line one with Mayor Anthony Copeland. Hey, you're on with the mayor.
Mayor, good morning.
Yes,
everyone.
Ma'am. Good morning.
I was wondering if there's anything possible that you could do on Riley Road coming off of Indianapolis onto Riley Road. Our tracks are so deadly. I mean, and nobody's helping us out here. And this has been going on for months. I mean, I'm talking about 5-6 months already.
Forgive me, Carla. I didn't hear you say our
Oh, I'm sorry.
You said our tracks?
No, I said the city tracks. The tracks are the railroad tracks as you're coming up Riley Road towards Markstown.
Okay.
And the tracks are very deadly, dangerous. They're completely dangerous.
Okay.
And nobody has done anything about it.
Okay, when you say dangerous, what problem
well,
are
if
you talking?
Well, if you're going, say you're going 30 miles an hour, and okay. if you don't slam on your brakes, you're going to hit the hose.
Okay.
And a lot of us have had a lot of flat tires on that. And one more question. And then here in Markstown, I always say Markstown, but I'll do it correctly, Markstown.
Yes.
Is there any help going to come from the sheriff department or anything else like that for the drugs?
Yes, I can tell you again, I was trying to allude to that earlier. Right now, we're working with Sheriff John Buntage. We're working with the FBI. We're working with CAP. We're working with local, federal agencies. A lot of things I can't tell you, but there is a task force that's together for drugs and gangs. You will see the results of these in the next coming months. You may even hear a major announcement in the first week of November dealing with a lot of cases from the past, a lot of unsolved things. Will be solved, and I think that you will see that there's been a lot of activity, but a lot of these things you just can't announce because when you do that, you know, you give forewarning, and people are set up shop and they move. So I would just tell you that this administration has opened up the doors of East Chicago. And we welcome all of the authorities to come in and work with us because we're fooling ourselves and we're putting our head in a hole or in the sand, like they say, if we think that our police department by itself can contain this problem. We can't.
209-845-1100. Anything else, ma'am?
Yes, just one more thing, Mayor. When this starts snowing, and Markstown is usually the last place they clean up, but we have a lot of landlords who don't even live here, and when it snows, it seems like most of their properties are so loaded with snow that we can't get through a lot of the streets.
Okay.
Is there going to be any law, hopefully, coming in that the landlords are the rented landlords, you know, who rent out their property, are they going to be liable for cleaning up their own snow? And I'll hang up and I'll listen for your answer.
All right. Thanks a lot.
Well, I can tell you that we have code enforcement. They're being very aggressive in that area that you're speaking of. We just passed a couple ordinances dealing with these absentee landlords. We have made it now where all of the water meters must be in the property owner's names so that we can, when we assess these fines, that we can now turn off the water if they do not pay these fines. I think that, again, in the coming months, you will see the results of now us setting up, working with the judge, putting these fines forward, assessing these fines, and being reimbursed for these fines. It will allow us to do more things than we ever have been able to do in the past. But I will tell you that sometime the last has to be first, and I guarantee you that Markstown will get the proper services that it should, and you won't be last.
209-845-1100. Mayor, a lot of people want to talk to you today. Let's go on. Hey, you're on the air. Hello, you're on the air. Hi, you waited so long, and then you got on the air and hung up. Hey, you're on the air. What's up?
Good morning.
Good morning, sir.
There, I hear you commend Hammond and Gary for some of the big box business they're attracting. Actually, I got two questions. Number one, what's your plan to attract business to East Chicago and bring in future business development? And number two, I can recall a young Anthony Copeland calling out and running on transparency, open public discussion, calling Pastrick and Pabe out to debate. What's your reason for not debating now? And aren't you doing the same things that Pastrick and Pabe were doing?
All right, let's take them in order. I think we addressed the debate again. I don't know if you want to answer them again.
Well, I think that the answer won't change. I think that the citizens of East Chicago deserve consistency, and that's what I've given them. I don't think that I'm subject to whim and folly, and I just don't entertain it. I didn't entertain it when I ran against Pabe. I didn't entertain it when I ran against Medina, and I'm not entertaining it now. I think that each of us owe it going to the people. I have went to the people, went to them when I asked for support in October, went to them when I asked for support in May, and because of individuals want to change their mind and try to make a condition where they think that they can just set up a condition that's perfect for them, I think they're fooling themselves. I think that down this stretch that should just do it the old-fashioned way. They should just go and meet the people. That's what my efforts will be concentrated on.
Your plan for economic development in general, I think it's kind of an open-ended question in East Chicago.
And it is. I think that it starts with restoring the business's confidence in the city of East Chicago. I can remember going to the last Lakeshore meeting, and a gentleman from ArcelorMittal came up to me, and I remember he hugged me, and he told me that economic development starts with, and he whispered in my ear, he said, credibility. And I never forget that. The industries are looking for us to form a new relationship. We've reached out to them, and I think you're going to see those fruits come to bear soon. We've had the ability to sit down and talk with ArcelorMittal about expanding our footprint along the lakefront when it comes to the development that we will be doing there with the RDA. We set in line to get our next big ask, they call it. You're now looking at the tax situation stabilizing to where before, you know, businesses would be paying like around $6 on every $100 on the tax rate. Now you look at three. You see, so it's ripe. The atmosphere is ripe now. So I would just say in these times when everyone is hurting, I think the businesses are looking for new relationships to be formed, and I think they're looking for credibility, and we're trying to do that through reaching out a hand and meeting with them when they call us to come to the table.
East Chicago Mayor Anthony Copeland is in the house. Mayor, I did bring up the to shift back to that woman's call, I was wondering exactly where those railroad tracks are. Looks to me that they're right north of Klein Avenue as they cross.
Yes.
Are those the ones she's talking
yes.
about?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I've driven that way. I don't remember them being excessively bumpy or anything. But these
are
the ones
they
that
are.
She's talking about.
I know what she speak of now. They are.
Okay, so.
We might take a drive by there because we've had increased truck traffic through that whole area, as you know, because of BP. But so there might something might have developed, so we might go by there.
Okay, there
but
it is.
But, Judd, I want to say one thing about that gentleman who called on transparency. I don't think any of the past two administrations have been as transparent as we have. As you know, we come on your station. We've gone to community centers. We've had every board meeting filmed now.
Mm-hmm.
That's never been done before. We entertain any visitor that comes into City Hall. If the mayor's not there, I'm there. No one's turned away. I don't think there's anyone that could say that we haven't made an effort to speak with them. I mean, the meetings at the community center, I mean, we went to every community center twice.
Mm-hmm.
And you could attest that no mayor has come to your show. I mean, I think it was a common joke where you would say, you know, here's East Chicago, and it would be silence. I mean, we've done everything we can, you know, to talk to people.
And not only that, Val, we've moved all of the board meetings to after 5 o'clock to where before they would be 10 o'clock, 12 o'clock, you know. Like a lot of times, people can just throw it out there, just like they've been slandering that we edit. And the mere fact that opponents can come to the council meeting and say whatever they want to about the mayor. And then you can see it on our channel 21 shows you transparency. And even when they tell lies as close to the truth as possible to make them believable, we still air them. I just think that if it's said in the public forum, if it's not profanity, if it's not just malicious to a person to where it can be liable, we just don't touch the filming. We just don't. What you see is what you get, you know. And but anyone can throw out there and say anything and hope it stick. But like I say, most of the time, I just don't entertain that type of stuff.
He's Mayor Anthony Copeland. Val Gomez, am I got right?
Yes.
I always forget. I just know Val. Sorry. Val Gomez and Anthony Copeland out of the city of East Chicago. I know you guys are still calling in, but our time is up. The veterans, you can hear them milling around in the background. Mm-hmm. They don't mess around when it's time for the veterans.
You know what, Jed? Let me say a few things in closing. I'm sitting here, my tongue and teeth is at war because you try not to just go there, and then you try to find the right words to say, and then you might find yourself stuttering a little bit because you don't want to go down in the mire, you know, because only a fool think you can go in the mud and come back up in a white suit and be stainless or spotless. It just don't work that way. And so I've never went there as a candidate and never will, no matter how much an opponent will try to draw me there.
Mayor Anthony Copeland, thank you. Thanks a lot, Val. All right, guys, AM 1230, WJOB, The Veterans Views is up next. The dead,
The dollar, 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 the doll